miserable world, as I do live by food, I met a fool who laid him down and basked him in the sun, and ran on Lady Fortune in good terms, in good set terms, and yet a motley fool. Good morrow, fool, quoth I.
No, sir,
quoth he,
call me not fool till heaven hath sent me fortune.
Then he drew a dial from his poke, and looking on it with lackluster eyes, says very wisely,
it is 10 o'clock. Thus we may see, quoth he, how the world wags.
'Tis but an hour ago since it was 9, and after 1 hour more it would be 11. And so, from hour to hour, we ripe and ripe, and then from hour to hour, we rot and rot, and thereby hangs a tale. Oh, when I did hear the motley fool thus moral on the time, my lungs begin to crow like chanticleer. That fool should be so deep contemplative, and I did laugh. Sans intervention, an hour by his style. A worthy fool, a noble fool, at least the only word.
What fool is this?
A worthy fool, one that hath been a courtier, and says, if ladies be but young and fair, they have the gift to know it. And in his brain, which is as dry as the remainder biscuit after a voyage, he hath strange places crammed with observation, of which he vents in mangled forms. Oh, that I were a fool! I am ambitious for a motley coat.
Thou shalt have one.
'Twill be my only suit.
Whoa! Oh, and eat no more.
Why, I have eaten none yet.
Nor shalt not till necessity be served.
What kind of this cock come of?
Art thou this bolden man by thy distress, or else would you despise her good manners, that in civility thou seemst so empty?
Forbear, I say, he dies that touches any of this fruit, till I and my affairs are answered.
You will not be answered with reason. I must die.
Oh, no! What would you have? You are a gentleman. Shall force more than your force move us to gentleness?
Speak you so gently? Pardon me, I pray you. I thought that all things had been savage here, and therefore put I on the countenance of stern command. Let gentleness my strong and forceful be, in which hope I blush and hide myself.
True is it that we have seen better days, and therefore sit you down in gentleness and take upon command what help we have, that to all your wanting may be minister.
Then but forbear your food a little while, whilst, like a doe, I go to find my fawn and bring you food.
Fawns?
There is an old poor man who after me hath many a weary step, limped in pure love, till he be first to fight, oppressed with 2 weak evils, age and hunger, I will not touch a bit.
Go, find him out, and we will nothing waste.
I thank you, be blessed for your good comfort.
Adam! Seest, we are not all alone unhappy.
Oh!
This wine of universal theater presents more woeful pageants than the scene where we play in.
All the world's a stage.
Sure, you
know. All the men and women, merely players. They have their exits and entrances. And one man in his time plays many parts, his acts being 7 ages. At first, the infant, mewling and puking in the nurse's arms. Then the whining schoolboy with his satchel and shining morning face, creeping like snail, unwillingly to school. Then the lover, like Fergus, with the woeful ballad made to his mistress's eyebrow.
What?
Then a soldier, full of strange oaths and bearded like the part, jealous and honored, sudden and quick in quarrel, seeking the bubble reputation even in the cannon's mouth. Then the justice, and fair round belly and good cape and line, with eyes severe and a beard of formal cut, full of wise saws and modern instances. So he plays his part. The sixth age shifts into the green and slippered pantaloon with spectacles on nose and pouch on side. His youthful host, well saved, a world too wide for his shrunk shape, and his big manly voice turning again toward childish treble, pipes and whistles in his sound. Last scene of all, that ends this strange ventral history. The second childishness and mere oblivion. Sans teeth, sans eyes, sans taste, sans everything.